Good afternoon. Congratulations on your perseverance. We've had an extraordinary conference up till now, and you will be richly rewarded for attending this last session. My job in it is to introduce Margot Käßmann. She is a church leader, an ecumenist, a scholar, a best-selling author, a public theologian, a world traveler, a mother of four young women, and a good friend of mine for almost 34 years. Reverend Dr. Käßmann studied theology at Tübingen, Edinburgh, Göttingen, and Marburg. She was ordained in 1985 and finished her PhD in 1989 at Ruhr University in Bochum with a dissertation on ecumenism with Reverend Dr. Conrad Reiser, who would in later years become General Secretary of the World Council of Churches. She received an honorary doctorate from the University of Hanover in 2002, and most recently this year from the Graduate Theological Seminary of Mexico. She has served as a distinguished professor at Ruhr University Bochum in Germany and here at Candler School of Theology at Emory in 2010. In 2009, she received the German Federal Republic Cross of Merit. Reverend Dr. Käßmann was ordained in 1985 and served as a pastor for some years, but already by 1983 was rising in leadership within the EKD, the Evangelical Church of Germany, when she was sent as a delegate from her church to the Vancouver Assembly of the World Council of Churches. Subsequently, she became General Secretary of the Kirchentag, the German Protestant Church Congress, which assembles more than 100,000 people of faith every 2 years for Bible study, lectures, discussions, concerts, and worship. The Kirchentag is a free movement of people brought together by their Christian faith and engagement in the future of the church and wider society. I'm delighted that groups of students from Candler School of Theology have gone to the Kirchentag in the past. In 1999, Dr. Käßmann was elected Bishop of the Evangelical Church of Hanover and served in that capacity until 2010. While in that position, she was also elected to be chairperson of the Evangelical Church in Germany, the position that John Woody described yesterday as the Pope of the German Church, a position she also left in 2010. Since 2012, Dr. Käßmann has served as the special envoy or ambassador of the Evangelical Church in Germany for the 500th Reformation anniversary celebration. I met Margot in 1983 at the Vancouver Assembly of the World Council of Churches. Her church sent her at age 25 as a first-time delegate, and my church, the United Methodist Church, sent me as a second-time delegate at the age of 30. I first encountered Margot at a meeting of the Women's Caucus, which gathered to strategize how we could pressure larger delegations like hers, mine, the Russian Orthodox Church, and others to include women in their delegated representatives to the WCC Board of Directors. My church had already named me as a candidate for service on the board, but the caucus convinced Margot to stand for election to the board, thereby going against the express wishes of the leaders of her delegation and against one of their chosen nominees, and Margot agreed. As a young mother, the leaders of her church thought she should stay home with her baby, but the women gathered in the caucus thought she should help lead the World Council of Churches while she also raised a family. Women and young people alike across the 1,000 delegates to the assembly cheered when Margot won the election to serve as one of five or so representatives of her church. And we should be able to say that the rest is history, but it's not. It took EKD leaders some years to begin to embrace the gifts, talents, and remarkable leadership of this amazing young woman, an experience most women of our age, and sadly even those much younger than we, continue to experience. Dr. Käßmann is a public theologian of the First Order. When she preaches in Germany and elsewhere in Europe, churches and assembly halls are filled to capacity. She is sought after by television and radio outlets for interviews. She writes a weekly column for the newspaper Bild am Sonntag, which has the eighth largest Sunday circulation in the world. She has written, co-written, or edited more than 50 books, many of them which have been translated into Korean, Italian, Dutch, Spanish, Japanese, French, and English. She's a best-selling author, with one of her books reaching the top of the list in circulation in Germany, and others selling to hundreds of thousands of people. Dr. Käßmann has an extraordinary capacity to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ alive and fully relevant to the everyday experiences of people, congregations, communities, nations, and world leaders. She exudes a fully ingrained integrity that keeps her centered in the midst of numerous personal and professional crises and challenges. And she lives and speaks with a level of authenticity that touches people deeply and personally. She has a passion for social justice that inspires many in Germany and elsewhere, inside and outside the church, to work for the common good at home and abroad. Governmental and church leaders alike have felt, sometimes quite uncomfortably, the results of her prophetic preaching and teaching. And yet they continue to heap honors on her as one of the most important religious leaders in Europe in the 20th and 21st century. I'm delighted to present to you my friend, Reverend Dr. Margot Käßmann.
I hope half of it is true. Thank you, Jen. Sounds great. Well, actually, I mean, I'd love to tell those Vancouver stories when we were young and daring to oppose our church. And later I became a bishop. That was the real joke about it. Yeah. Well, actually, I do not like to speak as a final speaker because during a conference like that, and I had thought I had heard everything about Luther and Reformation, but this was really enlightening. There were many new aspects. And then during a conference like that, you start to think, oh, you should change your paper because there are so many aspects that have been mentioned and new ones you would like to bring up. I'm often asked, and John Witte talked about that today, what would Luther say today about this and that and something else? The other day I was asked, what would Luther say about fracking? I have no clue and no idea. And so I want to start this last and final session of this fine conference with some sense of humor, because our church needs some humor, 2017. You can imagine who has not published a book about Martin Luther this year will not publish one. So we just had a book fair. It's crowded with books about Luther. We have Luther beer, Luther wine, Luther socks. Here I stand. We have Luther roses, we have Luther bread, and we have one export article that is today in the main newspaper of Germany. It's a Playmobil Luther, that's an ambassador. And this thing, the article today is headed in the German newspaper, he's greater than Darth Vader, because this has been sold 750,000 times in Germany. I already gave one to Jan, this one is for you, John, so. I'll give it to you later, okay. But that's not the end of my speech. Okay, I have 10 points, Michael Welker had 12 points, I have 10. The first one is the longest one and I'll hurry up, it's on nationalism. 2008, the EKD decided in cooperation with public bodies and tourist associations to launch a Luther decade leading up to the Reformation anniversary and making preparations for it. At the opening of the decade, and I found a nice quote of Bishop Wolfgang Huber, who's present here today and was then head of the Council of the EKD, he said then, I hope you remember, in his inaugural speech, I quote Wolfgang Huber, "As much as we value Luther's contribution to German culture, especially his impact on the formation of the German language, we have all the less reason to to repeat the claims to superiority in which Martin Luther is associated with a supposed German identity. For a long time, the figure of Luther was used to mislead Germans, both at home and abroad, into confusing patriotism with nationalism, unquote. I think that was a very important point if we talk about the challenges of the Reformation days and our challenges today. We live in a globalized world. That actually was already true in the 16th century. Anyone, for instance, who closely examines the records of the Imperial Diet of Worms in 1521 will realize that Luther's appearance there, while important, was only one of the topics dealt with. Actually, I'm not a historian, but when I read that book about the Diet of Worms, I was astonished. For me as a theologian, Luther's appearance was the thing on the diet, but there were many other topics. Emperor Charles V was striving for a reform of the empire. Belgrade had been conquered by Sultan Suleiman I, and the supposed Turkish threat was very high on the agenda. Securing sovereignty in the region of Spain was an urgent matter, with an eye already to the colonies. Movements for social revolution had arisen in the Kingdom of Valencia. Britain, France, Italy were also on the scene. And we can see that in the face of European expansion, particularly in direction of Spanish and Portuguese colonies, Luther himself had a very restricted view of the world. Heinz Schilling, one of his biographers, publishing his biography in German in 2012, says, quote, "The worldview of the reformer remained a continental one to his death and was rarely touched by the new emerging worlds," quote, unquote. And yet, isn't that interesting? Luther didn't see those emerging worlds, but his findings in theology very soon took on international proportions. In creating, in the real sense of the word, and we talked about it in the library today, the German language with his translation of the Bible, Luther became one of the founders of the German nation indeed. But he himself certainly did not think in such categories. It took another 250 years for the concept of nationalism to rise. But then when it rose, Luther became a key figure for nationalism. In the 19th century, German historian Leopold von Ranke regards the Reformation as the key event of the German nation and Luther as its founder. And so the Reformation Jubilee in 1817 was orchestrated as a religio-nationalist festival in memory of the Battle of the Nations near Leipzig, 1813. We became a nation. A nation needs a hero, apparently, and Luther became the German national hero. In 1883, with the 400th anniversary of his birth, Luther was promoted to being the founding father of the German Empire. In 1917, actually 1883 in the United States, you really celebrated Luther. 1917, nobody wanted to celebrate a German Luther in the United States of America. But in Germany, along with Hindenburg, he becomes the savior of the Germans in a time of great adversity. In 1933, the year when the National Socialists seized power, Luther was surrounded on his 450th birthday with the aura of a God-given great Führer who was only to be followed by an even greater God-given Führer named Adolf Hitler. And then on his 400th anniversary of his death, he was seen as the comforter of the German people in 1946, when Germans bitterly needed comfort. I only experienced one Luther anniversary. That was 1983, his 500th birthday, and then we had some sort of quarrel whether Luther was West German or an East German, because suddenly in the German Democratic Republic, Luther was no longer seen as the servant of the princes, which was up to then. The attitude now suddenly he becomes the representative of an early bourgeois revolution. Therefore, the Reformation does not only have relevance in the context of the church, but also in the state of Germany. And already in 2011, the Bundestag, our German parliament, discussed the 2017 centenary in a 90-minute public debate in parliament. And in the end, they had a unanimous vote in which it says, the posting of the thesis on 31st October 1517 by Martin Luther is seen as the catalyst for the Reformation. It had a lasting impact on society and politics in the last 500 years, not only in our country, but Europe-wide and worldwide. Among other things, therefore, our foreign ministry has an exhibition on Reformation, which you now can see in every consulate and embassy of Germany around the world. I find that very interesting. And our Chancellor, Angela Merkel, visiting our Synod in 2012, said, I quote her, Luther's decision to express his thoughts and doubts with words, to exhibit them publicly had, as it emerged, expressed the sentiments of many people and gave them the strength to have more courage to express their unease and their unsettled and unresolved questions. I say it quite openly, if one is still allowed to say that nowadays, Angela Merkel, this has a missionary component. I hope that something of the spirit of Reformation will once again reach people who have perhaps never, or at least not for a long time, heard about this spirit, unquote, says our Chancellor, the daughter of a Lutheran pastor, I must say. So what is this spirit? Certainly, first of all, it was about theological questions. Luther wanted to reform his church by referring back to the Bible, Holy Scripture, the Bible, faith, Christ, concentration on the essential. And he overcame the medieval fears of the agonies of hell and retribution for the sins of a lifetime, which tortured him like everybody else in his times. Nobody can buy themselves out of that. That's what he recognized. God is not a punishing, thundering God, but the God who turns towards you and promises you meaning to life. But soon Reformation had a political dimension. For instance, Luther expected the princes to deal with the abuses of the church if the Pope would not address them. In his famous letter to the Christian nobility of the German nation, he details the scope he sees for the need for reform, the feudal system, abolition of celibacy, and he declares that the Pope should not have any authority over the emperor. Likewise, he asked the princes to establish schools for every child, no matter what their social background, whether boy or girl. And I think we talked about that. This is a very crucial, a crucial point. Finally, he stands at the Diet of Worms and has his grounds on the writing of the on the meaning of the Bible and reason. In all that, Martin Luther was an exceptionally gifted political tactician. And I don't mean that negatively. Again, I refer to Heinz Schilling, who writes that the fact that Luther did not see bishops in a leadership role in the church of the Reformation, but rather held the princes that they should fulfill the key function was, quote, due to Luther's insight in the reality of powers, unquote. We know that, I shortened this, we know that Luther did not only make friends with that, Münzer, and he got into a great quarrel, and Luther called Münzer the Satan of Altstadt, and Münzer then said, he's the soft, fat life in Wittenberg. So they were not really friends. In the beginning, I think, as far as I read, in the beginning they might have been, but in the end, Luther did not even say a word about the terrible torture and killing of Thomas Münzer, which I think is one of the points where he didn't live up to his own commitments. Luther, following Paul, was convinced there has to be a distinction between the secular and the religious regimen. This is understandable in many ways, but it seduced the Lutheran Church to remain uncritical in the face of unjust relations. And the so-called doctrine of the two kingdoms or the two regimens appeared to quite a few Lutheran theologians and church leaders as a legitimization, not to name as absolute errors the crimes perpetrated, for instance, between 1933 and 1945. They remained silent, and many even after 1945. Celebrating Reformation in the 21st century, for me, therefore, is a challenge with regard to the growing nationalism. as well as nativism. We talked about that, Jan, during the weekend. We live in a globalized world. And we have actually, talking about ecumenism as about the whole world, overcome nationalistic concepts of Christianity. There is no German Luther in 2017, but there's a Lutheran heritage we share with churches around the world. And this is what we want to put on the table in 2017. We started on 31st October with a celebration, and then we sent a tour bus through 67 cities of Europe, collecting the European history and stories, a storytelling bus of Reformation. What did Reformation mean in your city or town? And where do you need reform and Reformation today? So I was in Turku just 2 weeks ago, and they asked in Turku, what is the Turku story of Reformation, and where do we need in society and church Reformation today? And it's great to see now they are slowly coming back to Wittenberg. They've met, have been in Geneva, in Rome, even in Madrid, in Dublin, in London, in Cambridge, in Amsterdam, and collecting those stories of the Reformation of Europe to show it's a European event, all in all. And furthermore, we will go on and say it's a global event. Just in brackets, there's some discussion in Germany right now because VW is sponsoring this tour bus, yeah. And I say, this is some sort of Protestant indulgence, you know, for what they do, so I think. What is even more important is that on May 20, we will celebrate the opening of a world exhibition of Reformation in Wittenberg. Wittenberg itself as town will be the exhibition grounds. There will be contributions from churches all over the world and also from non-church institutions who will come to Wittenberg and discuss for 16 weeks until September 10. And I hope you're all coming. I came to Atlanta, now you come to Wittenberg, self-understood. And we will discuss in 16 weeks, what does it mean today? Reformation and justice, Reformation and spirituality, Reformation and globalization, Reformation and peace, Reformation and ecumenism, and the dialogue of religions. For me, this is a key point. We will integrate also the Lutheran World Federation, the World Communion of Reformed Churches, and the World Council of Churches to celebrate in an international perspective. And that's very different from 1817, 1917. This time, we will, as Christians, say this is our common heritage, an anniversary in a global perspective. For me, that's very important in a time where nationalism is growing. I can say, I mean, you all know that. In France, in the Netherlands, even in Germany, too bad, I thought this would not happen again. And somebody said, why are we in the 80s, said, think globally, act locally. What, for instance, your president is doing in the United States is think locally and act globally. And that can be quite dangerous, as we all know. So this challenge of nationalism would be number one for me. And don't worry, the other 7 points are much shorter. They're getting shorter. Second challenge, it's the first anniversary we celebrate after 100 years of experience with ecumenism. I mean, when I came to Passau a few weeks ago, there was Archbishop Genswein, you know, that's the smart-looking guy from Rome. And we were greeted by the moderator of the two of us, and he says, well, here's Archbishop Genswein celebrating 2,000 years of his church, and here's Mrs. Käßmann celebrating 500 years of her church. And I said, this is a great misunderstanding. Luther already said 1541 that we are inheritors of the ancient church, Widerhandswurst. It's a common history we talk about. The churches of the Reformation are not new churches of the 16th century, but they are churches who developed out of the ancient church in a very different, in a way, of Reformation. And the Reformation time, the era, changed everybody. The Roman Catholic Church today is not the same church Luther has been fighting with. Already the Council of Trent said farewell to practicing the selling of indulgence for money. Second Vatican Council introduced the saying of the Mass in the language of the people, something that was demanded in Reformation times. Certainly, there will remain differences in our understanding of the church, of ministry, the teaching about Mary and the saints, but we have found that actually, especially in a secularized and continuing multi-religious world, there is more that unites us than what divides us. Many Roman Catholics today say that the 95 Theses of Luther probably would be accepted by Roman Catholics today. In 1999, we agreed in Augsburg that on the doctrine of justification by faith alone, we can have theological formulas that we agree on. In this respect, there's a great chance to give the Reformation Jubilee, the anniversary, a clear ecumenical dimension. And we can already see that growing. October 31st, last year, Pope Francis celebrated a worship service in Lund with the Lutheran World Federation, with the Palestinian Bishop Munib Younan, their president, the general secretary, Martin Junge, coming from Latin America, and the Swedish Archbishop, who is a woman. So a great picture of showing ecumenism is growing internationally, but also across our denominations. The challenge we face today, I think, is how we communicate with those churches who are not part of our ecumenical movement. We've talked about prosperity gospel churches today. Do we get into contact with Pentecostals? The other day, I met a pastor from China, mainland China, and she came with a clerical color, looking very clerical, and I said, oh, what denomination are you from? And she said, ah, we are post-denominational. We are not interested in European differences of the 16th century. So how do we get into theological or even other contact with churches like that, with people like that, with whom we are not really in contact? I think that's one of the great challenges of ecumenism today, because some people estimate that 50% of people calling themselves Christian today are not part of the traditional denominations we know so well. Third challenge, the dialogue of religions. It's the first anniversary of the publication of the 95 Theses since the Holocaust. And the failure of Christians in regard to the Jews in the National Socialist era has triggered a learning process. Especially in the year-headed Reformation and tolerance, we confronted ourselves in Germany with Luther's anti-Judaism, and especially you mentioned already the writing of 1543. Some historians say we even have to see him as an anti-Semitist. Simul Justus et Peccata, we talked about that theological insight, certainly means something for Luther himself. His hatred against Jews, especially in his old days, had its source in his anger that Jews wouldn't read the Hebrew part of the Bible as pointing towards Jesus as the Messiah. That is an explanation, but not an excuse. So it's important, before we start to celebrate, to confront ourselves with this. Thanks be to God, there has been a learning process. In Germany, we have more than 60 years of Jewish-Christian dialogue, and we can see that the Reformation churches are capable of dialogue. In November 2015, our synod distanced itself from Luther's writing on the Jews. And in November 2016, after a strong debate, heated debate, our synod declared that it will refrain from concepts of mission over against the Jews. You can imagine, that was quite a debate. The reformers themselves, though, said the church must always be reforming itself, and this is decisive already also today. But what's the global challenge then now? One of the global challenges in the consequence is to look at the growing anti-Semitism. Anti-Semitism is growing again. And we can see that in Germany, many of the migrants who come from a Muslim background suddenly bring a new anti-Semitism to our country, which we thought was overcome, because the Jews, for them, are the enemy in the teaching of their tradition. How do we confront that with our experience where anti-Judaism, anti-Semitism can lead to? And certainly the other great challenge is, if we need reformation today, how do we get into a substantial dialogue with Muslims? Although Luther may have ranted against the Turks, Today we live with Muslims in our countries. We need dialogue, and it must be grounded in theology. This is a task, a challenge still to be answered. I don't have the answer how we will really get into a good dialogue. But we see that Islam is becoming the enemy image in many countries of the world and also in the United States of America. Because only if we are in dialogue, we will contribute as religion to conflict resolution instead of pouring oil into the fire of political and economic interest via religion. I think that's a key global challenge for us today. Justice and peace. A learning process is also revealed by looking at the social movements and that dispute between Luther and Münzer. The question of conflict between the command to be subject to authority and the command to obey God rather than human beings. In my country, time and again, we are called that the churches should concentrate on the essential. And those politicians telling us to concentrate on the essential are mainly politicians who mean preach the gospel, but the gospel had nothing to do with our world today. It's nice for good people to behave well, but it has nothing to do with the world today. I have two examples which I will shorten. First is certainly migration. Yeah? Migration was also a consequence of Reformation. People of different denomination often left their country in order to find their freedom of religious practice, many of them immigrating towards the United States of America. Today, migration is a global challenge, a worldwide phenomenon. Therefore, we need a balanced view, and it's good if our churches contribute to a balanced view. The countries of Western Europe, in the countries of Western Europe, approximately 8 to 12% of the population are migrants. In other countries, we have up to 80%. I visited Lebanon last year. They have a population of 4 million and 1.9 million refugees in their country. But we leave those countries pretty much alone, and I must say, I mean, I can't discuss that now, but if you look at Greece and Italy, how they have to cope with thousands of refugees, and then European states like Poland, very Roman Catholic, very Christian nation. They refuse to take in European solidarity some of those refugees into their country. The churches have to have a clear voice on that. Migration is an irritation, that's no question. But to discover the riches of different cultures also is a great chance, and I cannot go on that, but the migration is full, the Bible is full of migration stories, and we would say Abraham and Sarah leaving because of a drought, I mean, they are economic refugees, that's what we would say today. Second example that certainly is war and peace. The theological differences of Reformation soon became part of political interests of the powers of the time. And the 17th century in Europe has seen 30 years of war, 30 years of killing, and in parts of Germany, that was not a nation then, but in parts of it, one-third of the population was killed until finally, 1648, we had a peace treaty. In preparing for 2017, we had a special year in 2014 under the heading Reformation and Politics, seeing the 100th anniversary of the start of the First World War and the 75th anniversary of the beginning of World War II. Reason enough to ask where the churches are challenged today and need to raise their voice. I'm convinced that we can make a significant contribution towards peace. First of all, discussing the production of weapons and the export of armaments. In Germany, I'm quite proud that our churches do that. Once a year, they give the report on armaments export to our government. I don't know whether they read it, but at least we give that report to the government. And we notice that wars around the world are always wars where somebody is making money, especially the weapons industry. The church has a mission, a proclamation of the word, and Christ for us is the Prince of Peace. So we have quite an interesting debate in Germany now after U.S. Minister of Defense James Mattis a few weeks ago called all NATO states to reach the goal of 2% of state spending on defense. This is widely discussed in our country. Is this really what the global challenges mean for our country today, or aren't there very different challenges we should meet? In that context, I think it's crucial not to duck away, but to engage, to question, to have controversial debates. And this is a global issue where the voice of the church is needed. Jonathan Walton has reminded us this morning that is the commemoration day of the murdering of Martin Luther King. And for many in Germany, he still is a key figure remembered. I just give you one example. It's interesting sometimes how actual the Bible is. Last year on Pentecost, I had an interview in this newspaper, in this monthly newspaper, instead of this weekly Sunday newspaper. Instead of having a column, it was a dialogue. And I was asked, what would Jesus say about terrorists? And I said, well, Jesus said, love your neighbor and pray for those who harass you. And then there was a shitstorm because people said, how naive is that? How can anybody see? And I said, I didn't quote Margot Käßmann, I quoted Jesus. I mean, it's Jesus who said that, you know? And there was such a debate about that. How can you pray for those who persecute you? That's impossible, stupid. And I said, it's very actual, I think, the gospel. And that's very interesting. Okay, point five. Women, the first anniversary on which the vast majority of Protestant churches throughout the world accept women in the ordained ministry and even as bishops. I can make that shorter because in the morning we heard a good speech on what marriage then meant. I mean, it was a theological sign that the good life is not the life in celibacy and in the monastery, but the good life is the responsible life before God in the world, with sexuality, with marriage, with raising children. And Luther, in this respect, could be tremendously modern. I have one Luther quote I want to give you because I think it's so nice. He's asked whether a grown man makes himself a laughing stock if he washes babies' diapers or nappies, I don't know what you say. One Luther quote. When a man goes ahead and washes diapers or performs some other mean task for his children, and someone ridicules him as an effeminate idiot, though that man is acting in Christian faith, my dear fellow, you tell me, which of the two is most keenly ridiculing the other? God, with all his angels and creatures, is smiling, not because the man is washing diapers, but because he's doing so in Christian faith. Those who sneer at him and see only the task, but not the faith, are ridiculing God with all his creatures. They are the biggest fools on earth. So, you do what you do in Christian faith, and even if you wash diapers, if you do it in your responsibility before God, it's okay. Luther's respect for women resulted in his teaching about baptism. When I became head of the Council of the EKD, the Russian Orthodox Church stopped relations with my church after 50 years because they said, if a woman is head of that church, we cannot have relations with that church because it adapted to Zeitgeist. I wrote back. We had some discussion whether I can write back if they don't accept the woman. And I said, but you accepted a woman, so I write back whether the patriarch reads it or not. And I said, it's not Zeitgeist. It's Luther's baptism theology. Every person who's baptized can be priest, bishop, pope. We don't have a pope, but so women. It took us 450 years to realize that, but women are baptized too. And so if we look at the global challenges today, it's a sign of the churches of the Reformation that women can be priests and bishops. I know there are some churches in Poland, even in New Zealand, who don't ordain women. But it has become a distinguishing sign of the churches of the Reformation. And for me, that's today an obligation to stand up as churches for women's rights in every country of this earth. Necessary not only, by the way, and that's something we must say. It's not only necessary to stand up for women's rights in the global south, if we look at some of the remarks of your president, we must say. Overcoming division, I just will say that one of the challenges I see for our churches is to overcome division, and especially, I mean, in the United States of America, you have 237 Protestant denominations. How can we give a sign to the world of unity if we are so divided that some of us can't even celebrate Eucharist with each other? And I now mean not the Roman Catholic Church, but Lutheran churches. There are Lutheran churches who are not ready to celebrate the Eucharist with one another, and you know about that, but I think that's a challenge. Seven, I'll shorten that, certainly because we talked about it, education. I think that education has two challenges today I want to lift up. One is we need educated faith over against fundamentalism. Fundamentalism in all religions of this world doesn't like education. Fundamentalism says you believe what you are told or you leave, or believe it or die even. So I think the matter of education is today a real challenge for us to say it's about educated faith. Ask questions, read yourself, think yourself. That's a challenge the Reformation brings to us today, and I think that's the most significant answer towards fundamentalism. And that includes, and that's my second point, historically critical exegesis. Time and again, I face people criticizing this methodology, especially from the evangelical side, even in Germany. But I'm sure Luther would have loved the knowledge we have today about the Bible, and that we discuss and are able to discuss why are there two creation stories, why are there different forms the gospel talks about the life of Jesus Christ. So the Reformation anniversary 2017 must make clear the churches of the Reformation are concerned about an educated faith. Point eight for me is the matter of freedom, and in the last session we talked about that, that's why I can skip that. The challenge of the freedom of faith of everybody is at stake, and even in our democratic societies. I remember that when I was Bishop of Hanover, there was a mosque about to be built, and they had a place where they wanted to build it, and overnight people put crosses there on which was written, Terra Christiana Est, this is Christian soil. And so, I mean, the freedom for Muslims in our country to practice their religion is sometimes at stake. So this freedom, I think, is the global challenge today. Certainly Christians are persecuted in some countries of the world, but I cannot make a Muslim wanting to practice his religion in Germany responsible for Muslim regimes, let's say, in Saudi Arabia. The ninth point for me is justification. We live in an achievement-oriented society in Germany as well as in the United States. And this society excludes the poor, the differently abled, the elderly. Justification by faith alone means every person has the same right and honors the same respect, whether they are rich, whether they are poor, whether they are able to make their lives, whether they are psychologically ill, or whether they think at least they are sane. The promise for life found by Luther is God has long since endowed your life with significance, regardless what you achieve for yourself. And that needs to be given a new translation in our age. And my final point, Michael Welker, Patrick Graham have already mentioned that Luther was of deep insight, but he was successful because of the media of his times as well. He could spread his thoughts so fast. He wrote in German and he wrote short. His scientific colleagues criticized that. What good thought can that be? That's not in Latin and very long. Huh? Discussions don't take place now in confined circles, but people can read the Bible now and they can discuss about the Bible. Luther's thoughts could not longer be deleted from the world because he could spread them faster than censorship could burn all his books. Book production, we heard that today, went up, and the single-page prints found a large audience. Very funny, especially at the Reichstag to Worms, they were still discussing what the result was when the leaflets were already out in the country. Luther has been standing there. For me, this example says we can use the new media today confidently, but critically. Not every social media is really social. And churches have to stand up for the truth, especially in times and eras of fake news. Truth has to be something the churches really stand up for. We especially need the media in an age of secularization, which sometimes makes it difficult to explain what faith means to us. Finally, the other day then I was asked whether Martin Luther also would use Twitter, like Donald Trump does. My answer was, yes, I'm afraid he would. No? My hope is, though, that the reformer would have undergone a learning process and guarded his sometimes violent language over against people of other opinion. Luther had many flaws, like many humans, like all humans, but he was deeply rooted in his faith. It was his faith he wanted to realize in the world, and in doing so, he became a political person. According to Luther, the vocation of the person is to be realized in the midst of life. In advocating that, Luther could also be humorous, spirited, profound, and sometimes eminently practical. One piece of advice to a speaker is, present firmly, open your mouth widely, and then keep it short. I stick to that, thank you.
Bishop, thank you so much for your talk. There's so many questions that I could ask you, but I'll just limit it to one, actually, for right now. I was struck by your comment when you referenced that you ran into a priest or a pastor from Asia, from China, and was wearing a collar and mentioned in the dialogue, which denomination are you, et cetera, and she says, oh,
but I'm not an expert on that, and I pose a challenge which I don't have an answer to, but for me, one of the problems is that many of these communities see themselves as based barely on their local community. You know, they don't want a larger community like the Lutherans, the Reformed, or maybe even the Landeskirche, regional communities as we have. I was in El Salvador in February, and one colleague there, Lutheran colleague there, said that the growing churches, the Pentecostal churches, often start in a garage. And if somebody starts to preach and he has 10 people in his garage, everybody gives the tenth of their income, then he can live from it. If he has 100, he's quite well off. If he has 1,000, he's rich. But it's then the community of pastor, let's say, Gonzalez, I'm sorry. but it's not a wider church. And I think we have to talk about the concept of church. Is church really just one local community, or isn't church a wider concept? And for me it is, and especially putting the global aspect on the table, they chicken out of the global obligations we have. And it's difficult to get into contact.
About 12 years ago, I visited China for the first time and was immediately invited to join a house church. And the most vibrant Christianity exists in house churches. They go to 30 and then they divide, and thousands and thousands of estimated millions in house churches. And I said to my wife, typical German professor, I said, well, it will not be easy here with the development. They do not have biblical studies here. They have only these philosophical theologies and so on. So we come to this house church, and in the middle of the service, they ask me, how do you interpret together scripture in your community? And I said, well, we have these Bibelkreise, Bible circles, so didn't say, never was in one of these. And then, then they looked at me and said, very seriously, is this really a church? So much for post-confessionalism.
I would also like to add the question whether China is the right example for the type of post-confessional churches you were rightly speaking about, because the special situation of the persecution of Chinese Christians during the Cultural Revolution led to two points. The first was they were studying the Bible in this time, but without having a Bible, because already to have a Bible was too dangerous. So they had to have the Bible and the hymns. They had to know them by heart. And they were meeting and exchanging that by heart. And they were pressed at the same time, in former times, to follow the three self rules. So what happened was that the three self movement was installed. Three self means self-proclaimed, self-governed, self-financed. And this three self movement is the post-denominational reality in China that is the church growing so fastly in our times. Mm. I mentioned that only because I wanted to propose not to use the example of China for the development you described rightly, namely a completely different landscape in the sphere of churches that in one way or the other are related to the Reformation. And my question now is how this kind of multitude and plurality within the movement of the Reformation is reflected in our celebration of the Reformation in this year, when we concentrate so much on Luther as we do in this moment. John Witte is the editor of a series in which a two-volume publication on Christianity and freedom just was issued. I looked in the index whether Luther played a role in the whole thing on Christianity and freedom. And my answer is there are two indications that Luther is mentioned. The first indication is absolutely meaningless. And the other indication is very important. It is in an article of John Witte on John Calvin, where he says, of course, Calvin was, in his understanding of freedom, a student, somebody who learned from Martin Luther. When we opened the Refo 500 in Taiwan, it was the Presbyterian Church who made it. When we look in the United States realistically, it's not the Lutheran Church only that is important to celebrate. And therefore, my question is, how we reflect that also in our German way to deal with that, but more generally, is it really a consistent answer to the global situation of Protestantism in its plurality when we concentrate so much on Luther? I become hesitant on that, and therefore I wanted to ask you very frankly, because living together in Berlin, of course, we have no time to discuss that in Berlin.
No, to point one, and also to Michael, well, this pastor I met in Berlin, she is from China, but you are right, China is a very special situation. It changed the last few years, as far as I know, but she's an example for something that would better be mentioned with regard to Latin America or other places in the world, or maybe maybe Korea, that's right. But she was from China. But it's a very special situation, I agree. To the second point, I mean, you, Wolfgang, were head of the Council of the EKD when the Luther decade was opened, and I know already then we discussed, isn't that too much Luther? But certainly many said, but he is the key figure and everybody will recognize that. And I mean, the church people were more hesitant, as far as I remember, to call it Luther decade. It was more the state people who said Luther, it's about Luther. We try hard, or at least I can say I try. Jan Hus, yeah, we will have the Czechs prominent in Wittenberg during this whole thing. We think of John Wycliffe, certainly Calvin and Zwingli, the Swiss, will be there in a pavilion the whole 16 weeks. They will be present in one pavilion together with the Roman Catholics, which I find quite a good idea. Calvin, Zwingli and the Catholics in one pavilion for 16 weeks. I try. But it always goes back to Luther. Somehow, I mean, he is the symbol figure, that's true, but it's very hard to make the other strong. And so I thought Michael Welker's speech was very good, showing all the differences. And I try to make the women of the Reformation strong, who often are not mentioned at all. But somehow, it always comes back to Luther. So. We try for the 16 weeks, and the critique is right, but somehow it's very difficult to get around Luther and his dominance.
Last question.
Thank you. It was an excellent talk and very challenging. It reminded me of a lot of Kirchentag, where you feel exhorted to go out and continue the Reformation. Two pieces from your talk I want to lift forward. One about the issue about anti-Semitism within Lutheranism, and one issue that I think I struggled with in time in Germany was the material culture, and I'm curious what you want to say about that. I'm thinking here material culture, like those images of synagogue that remain in so many Lutheran churches, of the blinded figure of the synagogue. So I guess I want to think with you about really the ways in which that kind of anti-Semitism has been refigured or reformulated. I don't have an answer to that, but I'm curious if you do, about how to really wrestle with that, because I think it's subterranean there. And the other one is about women, because I think you did a beautiful job of saying the principles of the Reformation support the priesthood of all believers, and particularly the ordination of women. But I'm wondering about the changes that women are bringing to what it is to be a pastor and a priest. So a question really, you could argue that that's the biggest change since the Protestant Reformation, that now women are pastors and priests. So thinking with, how do you see them rethinking or reforming what it is to be a pastor or a priest? Two really different questions.
Well, and I know I have to be short because we want to close the conference. I will give, you see, we cannot delete our anti-Judaistic, anti-Semitic history. But we can show the learning process. That for me is the only way to deal with it. And I will give one example. At the Stadtkirche in Wittenberg, there's so-called a Judensau. You know, it's a pig nursing Jews. That's from the 15th century, and it's awful. And when people say that, oh, take it off, we have to take it off to delete that history. But I think what the congregation in Wittenberg did was right. They planted a cedar tree from Israel underneath on the ground, and then they have a monument in the ground. It looks a little bit like a grave with the stones on top of it, like a Jewish grave, and it says in Hebrew and in German, with every Jewish life that was killed, the name of God was geschändet. What's that? Was hurt, huh?
Blame,
no. The name of God was heard with every Jew killed in Germany. And I think that's the right answer. This is what is our history, and this is the guilt and the learning process out of the guilt. And that's the only way. We cannot delete it everywhere, but we can show signs of a learning process. Like we are commemorating now in Berlin and other places, the people who have been taken away by the Nazis with their name. So don't delete it, but show the learning process in symbols. That's the only answer I have. And with regard to the women, it's just 25 years that the first Lutheran bishop, Maria Jepsen, has been installed in Hamburg. 25 years ago, I think the images have changed. You know, the first generation of ordained women wanted to be as good as men. You can read that in their biographies. They wanted to be just like the men, and nobody should see the difference. The second generation tried to be very feminist. Everything is female, everything we do. I think we are much more relaxed now, whether man or woman. We are in office, and we try to be good pastors. But the images have changed. Myself, when I was elected Bishop of Hanover 3 days after my 41st birthday. And after the election, I thought, whoa, what does a bishop look like? And I thought, not like me. I had the feeling, you know, a bishop is an elderly, important man. But now the images have changed. People don't think of a Lutheran or a Reformed priest anymore like a stubborn man who's teaching the Bible almost on God's place, telling you how to live. And I think that's part of women's ordination with regard to hierarchy, to family. I remember that my predecessor, my predecessor at the Kirchentag, I remember Carola Wolf, you remember her, we were sitting together, there was a press officer, and I said, I want to go home because I want to bring my children to bed. And she said, that's funny, your predecessor, he always said, oh, let's stay a little bit, I want to go home when the children are in bed. I think some of these work-life balance, these things have changed a little bit by ordination of women, and the images, that's for me most important. Sorry.
The Protestant Reformation had profound and lasting impact across the world. And thanks to John Whitty, we have been privileged at this conference to examine a number of fascinating arenas: the economy, a variety of societies with differences in culture, language, wealth, and poverty, and many other characteristics; the arts, especially music, but also all acts of creativity; the libraries, the Bible and biblical interpretation, family law, marriage, divorce, and the role of the church in such matters in Lutheran Sweden; the multidimensional meaning of justification by faith; capitalism, consumerism, and prosperity gospel; basic theological claims and passions of Luther; nationalism, nativism, globalism; the concerns, perspectives, and roles of women; justice and peace, religious freedom and other human rights; anti-Semitism, old and new; media, old and new; public theology and gilded scholarship, and so much more. We owe deep gratitude to John Whitty for his imaginative design of the conference and the gravitas with which he attracts some of the best minds in the world to bring their best insights to an intensive 2-day conference. The conference was rich with scholarly insights and depth of discussion. We also thank Amy Wheeler, Anita Mann, and Patty Gezi for their practical genius in ensuring that we were all comfortable, well-fed, and well-tended. We at Candler are privileged to be the junior partners in helping John achieve his vision, and we are grateful. Thanks to all of you, the scholars, the theologians, the church, and worship leaders. We listened to remarkable presentations, rich discussions, and a thoughtful sermon, as well as wonderfully meaningful worship this morning, which, by the way, is available at Candler School of Theology every Tuesday and Thursday from 11 to 12. We also are deeply indebted to the McDonald Agape Foundation, which has for a quarter of a century been helping to bring distinguished Christian professors and leaders together for powerful encounters such as the one here for the last 2 days. What a joy to be graced with the presence of three members of this great and generous family. And thanks to all of you for your presence, your perseverance, your wonderful contributions, your insightful questions, And your comments, not only in the formal sessions, but also around the edges over a cup of coffee or water or tea. As we go from here, we will be meditating on all that we've heard for a long time to come. So thank you again for coming, and go well as you leave this place. And we especially wish you well if you have to engage the Atlanta traffic, as John said earlier. Thank you so much.